nation. They will tell the children of your awesome power and your mighty acts. They will, of your faithfulness and glory.
And we will pass it on to all who've yet to come, how you've been slow to anger and oh so rich in love.
That only celebrates the wonders you have done. Give you glory, honor, blessing and praise. Together we'll pass it on, the greatness of your ways.
Indescribable are all your righteous deeds, incomprehensible is your unrivaled power, and all your promises will stand eternally. Upholding those who fall, uplifting those bowed down, you are near to all when it's to you we call.
So we will shout your name, we celebrate.
The mountain shouting. Take the glory, the praise, for it's all for you. It all belongs to you. We love you. We worship you in this place, and we praise you and thank you for all that you've done for us. Lord, I thank you for our 233rd birthday as a nation yesterday, the most wonderful nation in the world, Lord, that you have blessed in a million ways. Lord, we praise you for that. We thank you for our freedom to worship you here openly. And Lord, I pray that you would maintain that freedom, and I pray that you would work in our hearts today. Lord, we've not come here out of ritual or out of obligation. Lord, we've come here because we love you. We want to worship you, Lord. We want to worship you with our tithes and our offerings in just a minute. Lord, we want to worship you through song right now. We want to worship you through responding to the preached and taught word of God. And Lord, I pray that you would move in our presence today in a powerful and unmistakable way. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you please be seated? I want to thank you for being here on this Independence Day weekend. And a lot of folks are traveling and going on vacation. And I'm so thankful for the ones that have traveled and come on vacation here. I see Pastor Derek and Sarah have some family in town today. And Jonathan and Ashley Lighty have mom and dad here today. And there's other folks here who are here visiting family. Thank you for being with us today. Thank you for honoring us by being here. And I hope that you just have a wonderful experience worshiping the Lord in this place today. I hope that you'll get involved. It's not a spectator sport, folks. We are here to worship the Lord. And we want to walk out of these doors different than when we came in.
Is that your prayer this morning? Do you want that? I hope you did. And we have something a little bit special today. And in our service, a couple
things. First of all, be ready for our picnic later on this afternoon. We will be having one way or the other. And Chris Finz has organized and put that together, and he'll give you details at the end of the service on exactly what we're doing. But for today, in this service, we have a very, very special guest, and that is Ron Lighty. Ron Lighty is Jonathan Lighty's dad. And Ron is a wonderful man of God. He and his wife are here today. They're from the Oak Ridge Baptist Church. He works as a barber during the day, but he has been ministering for over 36 years in public schools, Christian schools, nursing homes, and in just a variety of ways, using his gift of ventriloquism and storytelling and some things you're going to get to see in a very special way today. So at this time, we're not doing Kid Zone today because Ron Lighty's here. And so I'm going to ask all of our children, and we're not going to give an age to that. You may be 55, but you feel like a child. If you want to come forward, you can. All of our children, I would ask that you would stand up, elementary age kids and younger, and make your way up to the front. We haven't done this in a long time, have we? Come sit up over on this side right here. So stand up, kids, come forward, and I want to introduce you. In fact, why don't you give a special welcome to Ron Lighty and Jason.
Hello there, boys and girls. I guess this is on, okay. All right. This is my friend Jason Basswood. And Jason, can you tell him a little bit about yourself?
Well, I think that was a tree.
That's right, a basswood tree.
And the tree grew up nice and tall, and they cut it down, and they get in the little, and the little, and the little, and well, here I am. A little boy.
That's right, a little boy. And, my, it's good to be here. And you know what, Jason? What have you been doing?
I've been out fishing.
Fishing?
I got two fish. That's Sam and John.
Oh, you even named them too?
Yeah, sure did.
Oh, my. Well, listen, this is great.
How many of you want to hear about my fish story? Raise your hand. That's good.
Yeah. Jason, this is a time of worship, and we need to tell them about the Word of God.
But I'm going to tell them about my fish story. I went out there, and I baited my hook, and I got two big old fish. Isn't that good?
That's right.
But you know what?
What's that, Jason?
You know what? There's a story in the Word of God about a little boy.
A little boy. And he went fishing, didn't he?
He sure did.
And he was down along the Sea of Galilee.
Yeah, and one of the disciples come to get that little guy.
Oh, when he started out, I imagine his mom packed him a lunch.
Yeah, 5 barley loaves of bread, and he went out fishing.
And he got 2 fish, didn't he?
He sure did.
And my 5 barley loaves and 2 fish?
That was the first fish sandwich, huh, preacher?
Well, never thought of it that way, but I guess so. First fish sandwich. And Andrew got that little fella and took him over there to where the multitude was.
Yeah, and that little guy, he went out there, and he went to see Jesus, and he gave him the 2 fishes and the 5 barley loaves.
Oh, my goodness. And what did Jesus do?
He multiplied them.
There was, how many people were there?
5,000 people. Ain't that right?
That's right. And my, there were 5,000 people there, and he multiplied it into a miracle.
A big miracle. It wasn't no magic.
Uh-uh. No, it was a big miracle. And all the people had something to eat of the bread of life there, and the 2 fishes, and it was a miracle there, 5,000 people.
And they had some leftovers.
That's right, leftovers. And they went and picked up those leftovers as well, and they had enough so everybody could eat.
Get filled up like a pig.
Well, yeah, you don't say that to a Jew, but yeah, they were filled up. That's exactly right, they were filled up.
Sure were.
Yeah, they were filled up, and they had lots of left over. But my goodness, you know what? That was a wonderful thing, wasn't it?
Sure.
And what about that little boy?
Well, he gave them the fish, and he gave the bread.
Uh-huh.
And you know what? I'll bet the little guy stood there and said, Lord, you know, here am I. I'm just a little boy. Can you use me?
Yes. You know, that's very important because, you know, that little boy, if he gave him his fish and gave the bread, I'm sure that he gave his life to Jesus.
And that's important, huh, boys and girls?
To give your life to Jesus Christ. And how do you do that?
Well, realize you're a sinner.
That's right. Realize that there's a heaven or hell.
Uh-huh.
And realize that Jesus died upon the cross.
And every little girl can ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart and save you.
So you can go to heaven.
I don't got no heart.
I know.
Lady, I don't got a gizzard.
I know that. I know that. But you know, every boy and girl, they have a heart and they have a soul, don't they?
They sure do.
Uh-huh. And they could ask Jesus Christ to come into their heart and to save them.
Amen.
Amen. And that's a wonderful thing, isn't it?
It sure is.
Well, Jason, it's time to say goodbye.
Gotta go?
Yeah.
You see that kid with the yellow shirt down there?
Yeah. Yeah.
They can get the suitcase.
No, Jason. Jason, you got to get in the suitcase back there.
They can get in there and I'll stomp on the lid.
No. No, Jason, you got to go there.
Maybe I go over and play with his toys. You got any video games?
No, Jason, this is not time for that. Okay, but Jason, but boys and girls, I hope you remember the lesson there that Jason tells about that, okay?
Amen.
Amen. Well, Jason, you say goodbye to everybody.
Oh, yeah, and the grandpas and grandmas, too.
That's right, yeah.
Glad to have grandpas and grandmas here and mothers and dads.
That's right. And you know what this special day is?
Happy birthday to America.
That's right, it certainly is. Well, Jason, it's time to say goodbye.
Bye, boys and girls. Bye. You'll be good.
Thank you. continue to worship our Lord. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching.
Thankful for over this holiday period. We're thankful for our country, for our freedom, and most of all, we're thankful for our salvation. And Father, we're thankful for everyone who has come out today, and we pray that this service will be a reminder of what a wonderful God we have and what a wonderful country we live in. We thank you, Lord, for your love and mercy, and I pray now that you'll bless the service and the offering.
to officers training school that was a commissioned officer that was a flag officer that was shot down.
Let's stand and do just that and remember those who have fought and those who have died so that we're able to say the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Please be seated.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's important that we remember that we are a nation at war. While we worship the Lord freely today in comfort and air condition, comfortable homes, comfortable clothes, our men and women in uniform are out protecting our freedom in places like Afghanistan, Iraq, and other places, Kosovo, and around the planet. And listening to that beautiful speech reminded me of that old song. You remember the old song that says, I pledge allegiance to the land. Our loyalty, our complete allegiance is to the Lord Jesus Christ. And we remember that He has blessed us tremendously by allowing us to be born in or even as my father-in-law was, to move at the age of 30 to a free nation. He's a tremendous patriot. In fact, he's very proud because his seminary has just commissioned several Army chaplains to active duty. I have a good friend, a former roommate of mine that's a missionary chaplain in Iraq right now. And he's put on his Facebook last night that he's just waiting for leave to get out of the sandstorms. And it's just cruddy conditions over there, even on a good day. Of course, our very own Wayne Martin is over there. And we pray for our soldiers, those in uniform. We thank God for those who have made the ultimate sacrifice. And we do pledge allegiance to that flag. We do understand that America is something very important. It's worth fighting for. It's worth dying for. It's worth standing for. Our country is a great and awesome nation. And even with all of our problems, we live in the greatest nation in the world. So happy Independence Day. And I would ask that you pray for me and my family. We just came back from an unbelievably wonderful week of vacation in Florida and just having a great time. And then everybody got sick. And this will not be the longest or the best by any stretch sermon that I've ever preached. I can assure you of that. But I can also tell you I've probably never done more to try to be here than I have today. We left Florida early because the kids started getting sick, and we hit the road. Right now, all three of my children and my wife are sick in bed, and I might be next, so don't get too close to me. In fact, we're going to do Lord's Supper a little bit differently today, and you'll see at the end of the service, we'll have our deacons take the various elements to the back of the room and to the front of the room, and you will be given an opportunity during our invitation to come and take the juice, take the wafer, and to have your time together and take it back to your pew. And we'll mix that up a little bit today and keep me away from all of it and hopefully keep my germs away from you. But we drove long and hard to be here. We were hoping the whole family could be here. My son is going to be so unhappy. John is going to be so unhappy when he realizes that he missed Ron Lighty and Jason. He just loves that kind of thing, and he would really, really want to be here today, but he can't be. He's very sick right now. But if you turn over in your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, I've titled my sermon this morning, Remember America. Remember America. You see, it's essential that we evaluate ourselves regularly. That's why we take Lord's Supper. To recognize, to remember, to evaluate, to think back, to self-evaluate. It's absolutely vital that we evaluate ourselves and make the necessary changes that God requires. Otherwise, we're just wasting our time. If we're here having a religious meeting, maybe singing some patriotic songs, some swooping worship songs that make you feel good, and maybe even going out and having a hot dog this afternoon at our Independence Day party picnic, we have accomplished very little. In fact, this text criticizes the people of Corinth for that kind of behavior. You know, this coming Tuesday, hundreds of thousands, probably millions, have tried to get into the funeral services, the memorial services for Michael Jackson, to stuff into a 20,000-seat building where probably 10 times or 20 times or 100 times many people will be turned down than will be allowed in. To say goodbye to the so-called king of pop who died unexpectedly last Thursday. It has been amazing. I've tried not to watch the television on vacation because it's so depressing. I've definitely stayed away from the news, but it's hard to not know that, you know, Ed McMahon passed away. Yesterday, Steve McNair, MVP quarterback, died. He was murdered in Nashville, Tennessee. Of course, Farrah Fawcett died. Michael Jackson died. And I actually pay attention to those things. Maybe you do too. Maybe that's embarrassing to admit that you actually pay attention to celebrity stuff like that. But you know, it's such a powerful reminder that no matter how famous you are, no matter how rich you are, no matter how loved you are by so many people, your life is not going to last forever like this. And it's uncanny to see some of these people who were given tremendous fame and wealth and all that, that die. 51 is a relatively young age to fall over dead. And I can't imagine very many songs that Michael Jackson sang that would be appropriate to share this morning. I'm not going to try to do that. We don't have a video for you or anything like that. But I do think there is one song that fits today. If only he had personally observed the lyrics of this one that said this: I'm starting with the man in the mirror. You've heard that song. I'm asking him to change his ways. He goes on to say, take a look at yourself and make a change. There's a nugget of truth in that, isn't there? Take a look at yourself. Look in the mirror. If a pop icon can preach that message on MTV, can we not think about it today in church? Evaluate yourself. Self-evaluate. It's essential that we do this and that we make the necessary changes that God requires. You see, He is requiring certain things of you and of me, and He is sovereign God. He's almighty. Now, you're not a robot. He's not going to reach down and make you do anything. But He does have a certain standard that He expects. Of course, we can rebel. You can choose to rebel. But there's a hefty price tag to pay when you do that. His requirements are not up for discussion. His standards don't change. His standards weren't one thing 300 years ago and a different thing now. His standards certainly weren't one thing when the Bible was being written over a 2,000 year period, but something different now, 2,000 years later, after the canon has been closed. The canon of Scripture. So let's read about His requirement concerning this ordinance that we celebrate every single month, most every month, called Lord's Supper. Are you there in Luke, in 1 Corinthians 11? Starting in verse 17, it says, "Now, in giving these instructions, I do not praise you, since you come together not for the better, but for the worse." Paul is writing to the Corinthian church. I'm sure if you've been in church very long, you know that the Corinthian church was bad. Bad apples. They were really messed up. So he's identifying some of their problems, and he's going to give them some good doctrine here too, some instructions. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 18. "For first of all, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you. And in part, I believe it. For there must also be factions among you, that those who are approved may be recognized among you," meaning that it can be pointed out who the ungodly people are, the people who have factions, who play favorites, who cause trouble and dissension. So you can recognize that they are not children of God. They are not spiritually mature people. "Therefore, when you come together in one place, it is not to eat the Lord's Supper. For in eating, each one takes his own supper ahead of others. And one is hungry, and another is drunk. What, do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and shame those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I do not praise you. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you.'" A better translation of that word is given or offered for you. We know that Christ represented, or the Old Testament sacrifice, that sacrificial lamb represented Christ. And the lamb was never broken. His bones weren't broken. Christ's bones were not broken on the cross. The centurion, of course, stabbed him, speared him, but they were going to break his leg so he couldn't get any more breath, but they didn't need to do that. He was dead. So his body was offered for us, given for us. "Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself." Let a woman, let a teenager, let anybody who's going to partake in this very serious, somber, reverent ordinance, examine themselves. "And so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner," listen, "this person eats and drinks judgment to himself." Who takes the Lord's Supper? Christians or non-Christians? Christians. So this passage is telling us that as a Christian, you can be judged for taking the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many even sleep, meaning they are dead. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened by the Lord, that we may not be condemned with the world. Now, there's a difference between being disciplined or judged and being condemned. The lost person is condemned. The world is condemned. Therefore, and that's why Jesus came into the world. God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. The world's already condemned, John chapter 3. Therefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. But if anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, lest you come together for judgment. And the rest I will set in order when I come. And can you imagine being those Corinthian folks realizing Paul's coming to set things in order? We better get things straight. We better get things right. On July 4th, 1776, our forefathers risked their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor to sign the Declaration of Independence. After many days of haggling over the details, they had found themselves at an impasse. You've probably heard the story. Maybe you haven't. Based on the recommendation by Ben Franklin, they decided to adjourn their meetings for prayer, to spend a weekend in prayer and crying out for sovereign wisdom from Almighty God. Soon after that, they reassembled and were able to complete and unanimously affirm the Declaration of Independence. This weekend, yesterday evening, America turned 233 years old. We are one of the youngest nations on the planet. Still, at 233, that's a very young nation. But our system of government is the oldest. Our Constitution, our Bill of Rights, our laws were written from a Christian perspective based on the Word of God. And they have stood the test of time longer than any other government on the planet, even though we're the youngest nation on the planet. Even with today's relentless ultra-liberal attack on Judeo-Christian values, we are still standing. Let's not be defeatist. Let's not cry and go home and roll around in fetal position and say, oh no, what are we going to do? We're going to do what the church has always done. We're going to stand when it's politically correct, when it's not politically correct, when it's popular, when it's unpopular. Regardless, we're going to stand. We're still standing. And it's vital that we stop to remember from where we came so that we can wisely decide where we're going. It is essential that we evaluate ourselves and make some changes. Here, of course, our nation, many well-meaning folks, and I'm sure they're well-meaning. I give them the benefit of the doubt. They've completely forgotten our nation's true origins. Maybe they were never taught it in school. Maybe they were never taught it by their parents. Maybe they never went to a church like this and learned it at church, or they never just opened up the history books. They are willfully ignorant of the simple fact that America was uniquely designed to be home for people who are, and I quote, endowed by their Creator, capital C, with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. As American Christians, we partake, as Christians all over the world, but specifically as American Christians, we partake of communion today and celebrate our independence from sin, from self, our independence from Satan, and we acknowledge our dependence on the Lord as individuals, our dependence on the Lord as a church, our dependence on the Lord as an individual. We're not independent from God, folks. We're dependent on God. Today, let's evaluate where we are. Let's look again in the mirror of God's Word and prayerfully make the changes that God expects us to make. I can tell you, I've come a long way to give you this message. This is very powerful on my heart. I stayed up late Sunday night watching the internet. And I want to thank John Smuda and all of our video workers. And there are many. To mention all the names would be impossible. But that have put a lot of time. David Roten, over the years, put a whole lot of time into our video ministry. And these ones operating the different cameras. And our the whole service is on television for you to watch every Friday night. Or on the internet, you can watch it anytime you want. And on the radio on Friday night. And that's pretty neat. We're taking our message all over the world. But on Sunday night in Kissimmee, Florida, I pulled up last Sunday's message. And it was powerful. It was absolutely powerful. It was fresh, too. It had just been preached about 12 hours earlier. And it put a burden on my heart. And I know, and I couldn't watch it. I was just listening to it. But I know that many, many, many of you were powerfully affected by it. If you didn't hear last Sunday's message from our youth pastor, Pastor Derek, you need to get that DVD or just pull it up on the internet if you have it. He encouraged us in this way. And really, from that moment until now, I really couldn't wait to get back home. Tried to enjoy my vacation. And man, was it was a long process getting here. I was at the emergency room last night at 3 o'clock in the morning, this morning. Didn't get a good night's sleep. But I believe the message that God has given me and the message from God's Word could be life-changing for somebody. It could be. Look back at verse 17. It says, they come together not for the better, but for worse. That means, literally, moral evil. Do you realize that people go to church all over America for the worse? They are on a road to hell. They've never been given the simple gospel. They've been fed a social gospel. They've been fed a work salvation. They've been fed lies. And they are sincere, and they are religious, and they think they're on their way to heaven, but they're lost. In many cases, the church in America is the biggest opponent to the gospel, the biggest opponent to revival, the organized denominational structures that we see all over our land. They say in the political realms, everybody is so polarized right now to the right and to the left that there's a very small sliver of people in the middle that are actually open-minded. About 7% of the population is actually open-minded. They call them swing voters that are actually seriously willing to look at going either way when they vote. But they say the most controversial topic, the biggest thing that brings controversy in politics today is religion. Religion. Some people think that they are doing God a favor with a far left liberal wacko idea of what the gospel is. Their church might say Christian on the front of it, but it's not Christian. And they come together not for the better, but for worse. The carnal church at Corinth celebrated what they called love feasts in the first century. And at the end of the love feast, which included gluttony and drunkenness and revelry, they had to drag God into it with the Lord's Supper. Paul rebukes them for this and for allowing the poorer church members to come and leave the party hungry. He goes on to confront the church members for their factions and their little cliques. That's what we would call them today in modern vernacular. They're cliques. He rebukes them for that. You see, communion is to be a celebration of our relationship, of our communion with the Lord and our community as a body. But sadly, modern day churches, many of them resemble the first century church at Corinth. Many Christians are characterized by pride. P-R-I-D-E, pride. Many Christians are characterized by carnality, worldliness. The cliques, the same cliques that happened then are happening now. Lack of moderation, addiction, immorality, prejudice, jealousy, self-centeredness, selfishness, hypocrisy, and brazenly ignoring God's standard. We know God's standard, but we don't take it seriously. I met a man by the name of Eddie in the pool this week. Eddie is a New York City police officer, a good man, a really neat guy. I enjoyed getting to meet him and his wife and his beautiful children. Eddie told me he believes we've not learned the lessons of 9/11, that America has forgotten that God is the one who has protected and blessed and prospered us. And we've turned our back on him and embraced immorality. You see, Eddie is an 18-year veteran of the NYPD. He lives in Manhattan. He doesn't drive to work. He lives where he works as a police officer. He grew up in church, but he was lost. He came back to the same church and got saved. He was born again as an adult, and he brought his wife back with him. And she, of course, she thought they were crazy. But eventually, she gave her heart to Jesus. And their little children, they're raising up in a Christian home now, standing for the Lord in downtown Manhattan. This man watched the Twin Towers fall with his own eyes from just a couple blocks away. He saw it with his own eyes. It changed his life forever, and he never feared for his own life. He told me that, his own testimony. He said, I never feared for my own life. But he does fear for his nation because we've lost our way. We've forgotten the one who made America so great. You see, Eddie believes that America has kicked God out of so many of its public institutions that we should not be surprised when God lifts away his hand of blessing, his hand of protection, his hand of prosperity. And here we are, sitting in a mess, in an economic mess, in a moral mess, in a military, in a war mess. So today, before we take or partake of the Lord's Supper, I would ask you, examine yourself. Could it be that Eddie's right? Could it be that this man's right? We need to evaluate where we are with God and be honest about our spiritual condition. Let's not be hypocritical about this. Be transparent, be open, be authentic about where you are with God today. I don't know if you've had anybody try to sell you a car or sell you anything. Salesmen can be kind of pushy. They can kind of be in your face, right? And they want a decision right now. Of course, my first answer is, dude, I don't ever buy anything on the spot. I've never bought anything on the spot in my life, never gonna. So you can dance or spin or flip, but I'm not going to buy anything. I'm not going to buy a toothbrush on the spot. In fact, I bought a toothbrush on the spot, and the little prickle things were too hard, hurt my gums. I wish I'd waited for my wife to get me a nice soft one. Feels better. But today I'm a salesman, and I'm here to push you and tell you, you need to make a decision today. And I'm not talking about coming to an altar. The altar will be open for you to do that if you'd like. I'm talking about a decision for yourself, a decision for your family, a decision for your future, a decision that will affect what you do this afternoon, this evening, tomorrow, when you get up and go to work, and the way you live your life. Now, you can't put it off. Don't put it off. This isn't something to ponder and go, boy, you know, God's standard is here, but my lifestyle's down here. I'm going to debate and think about and do a checklist of whether or not I should meet up to his standard with my life. You're wasting your time doing that. You need to repent. You need to deal with it. In verses 23 through 26, we see the details of how to do the Lord's Supper. Now, this information was not new for the Corinthian church. Paul had previously communicated to them the importance of the Lord's Supper. But they had turned it into something that it was never meant to be. You see that in the text? They turned it into something totally different. Is it possible that the same thing happens today? Is it possible? We're going to do Lord's Supper differently today. It may be that you'll forget every single thing I said today, but you'll always remember the day we did Lord's Supper differently. Praise God that we did something differently. Thank God that we can do that. Not to say that the way we always do it isn't the way to do it. I kind of like doing it that way. It's easy for me to remember what to do. But this church had completely lost touch with what it was all about. Look at verse 24. Jesus' body was given to us. It was offered to us as a sacrifice. Verse 24 and 25, we see this statement twice. Do this in remembrance of me. Do you see it there? Do this in remembrance of me. We're commanded to remember and memorialize Jesus on the cross. It is healthy to stop and to look back at Jesus on the cross, to think about it, to personalize it, to realize the sacrifice that he paid to purchase our spiritual freedom. And no better day than Independence Day weekend to think about that in a temporal sense too, with those 5,000 plus soldiers that have given their lives just in the last few years for our freedom, for the cause of freedom. And then verse 26, it says this. You proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. You proclaim the Lord's death by doing Lord's Supper until he comes. It's vital that we look back, and it's vital that we look forward at the same time. Think about this. We're looking forward to the return of Christ. We proclaim his death and his coming or until he comes. We also look in the rearview mirror. It's kind of like driving a car. You look forward and you look in the rearview mirror. If you don't keep an eye on what's going on behind you, man, you can get yourself in a lot of trouble. Don't spend too much time keeping an eye on what's behind you. You're going to run right into something. It takes both, doesn't it? That's why we have mirrors and we have a big old windshield to look ahead to see what's coming. When we look back, we see that the prophets promised, they predicted, they prophesied that Jesus would come. And he did. They also prophesied, and they didn't really understand it. They didn't get it, but Isaiah 53 certainly prophesied of a suffering Messiah who would die. And Jesus himself said, I'm going to go in the ground, and I'm going to come up 3 days later, destroy this temple, and 3 days later it'll come up. The disciples sure didn't get it, and don't be too haughty. Neither would you have if you'd have been there. I certainly would have, right over their heads. But Jesus predicted that he would die, be put in the ground, and raised from the dead. And he did. And he said he would come back. And he will. So we look forward, and we look back at the same time. Last week, I gave a little video message to the congregation about the DVD player in our vehicle that was so cool. Kids could watch movies as we drove down the road, VeggieTales and whatever. Friday the 13th, just kidding. But they were quiet, they were well behaved. They just sat there and so peaceful. But I thought so much about that. How America is sitting in the back seat of a big, beautiful, cushy, comfortable vehicle watching entertainment as the vehicle we're in is going the wrong way on a one-way street. And folks, there is going to be a collision. There's going to be a catastrophe. We are in love with entertainment. A Presbyterian minister recently said, by the name of Godfrey, he said, the American church is amusing itself to death. We prefer being entertained versus being challenged. So today, evaluate yourself. Today, think about what Jesus did on the cross. Think about the fact that we are proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. That's what it's all about. Not your central heat and air, not your caravan, SUV, not your corner office, not all that. Jesus Christ is coming back. It could be right now. Are we ready? Are you prepared? What about all those people out there that have yet to hear? What are we doing for them? We learned last week that our international mission offering was $30 million below projected targets. There are hundreds of missionaries that are in the pipeline that will not be going. Most of them are on short-term mission trips that will not be going unless something changes. So we as a church, we didn't hit our goal. Do you remember back in Christmas time, we didn't hit our goal. And thousands of churches just like ours didn't hit their goal. And we had choices to make. Do we go out to that fancy restaurant Friday night? Or do we go ahead and stay in and eat something out of a can and support a missionary to go out and tell the world about Jesus? You proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christianity is a barbaric faith. Our leader died on a cross. He was bloodied. We need to turn off the distractions and tune into what God is doing all around us for his own glory. I spent time with a lady yesterday in just an amazing situation. To be honest with you, I didn't want to deal with her. I didn't have time for her. I was in a hurry to get home to preach my sermon. And this woman wanted a ride. And I'm like, lady, you don't want to get in that car. I promise you, you don't want to get in that car. There was no room for her anyway. But Elizabeth said, you're awfully short with her. Oh, man. You're right, honey. But I'm in a hurry to get home and do the Lord's work. And would you believe that crazy motel we were in? And it was not the nicest one you've ever seen, but it had a second entrance. As we were leaving, there was a second entrance to the same motel. And God, I really believe he reached down and put his hands on my hand and said, get back there, you hypocrite. So I did. And we helped her. We found her. And that was a process in itself, just finding her. We spent a lot of time with her. We did what we could for her. But I sat down with this young lady, 29 years old. She looks like she's in her 40s. And I tried to share the gospel with her. And I tried to lead her to Christ. But do you know what she wanted to talk about? She wanted to talk about her church and her woman's Bible that her and her old man read. The man she lives with. The man she's not married to. She's married to another man. She still has the ring on her finger. She's a recovering heroin addict. She's on the side of the road with her boyfriend and her cousin because they got drunk and got kicked out of the car they were in. She's totally stuck. Her life's a complete mess. And every attempt I made to just share the simple gospel was met with, well, I did this, I did that, I go there, I read that. I wonder how many people go to church each week. That inside, they may not be on the street, they may not be stuck on the side of Interstate 95, they may not be a heroin addict, but they come to God all the time with all their works and their good deeds and their ideas of how good they are. Folks, when you look at the cross, and when we look at the cross, we need to remember, it's all about how bad we are. That's why He hung on the cross. That's why Jesus spilled His blood for our sin. That's why He did that. We could never be good enough, even as Christians, to come back with works and say, oh, God should be so happy to have me. I did this and I did that. Folks, we need to remember that bloody cross, it took just as much as Christ's blood to forgive you of your sins as it did Hitler or Saddam Hussein. Look at verse 27. Let's get ready to take Lord's Supper. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. What does unworthy manner mean? Well, it means with an unrepentant heart. Ritualistically, whoop, whoop, I did my deed. Let's move on to whatever's going on this afternoon. Just a ritual. It means nothing to you. Don't do it if that's the case. It's going to be harder to do that today because you're going to have to get out of your seat and go get it and then go back to your seat and take it. It'll be fun to see how all that works. An unworthy manner means with an unrepentant or an irreverent attitude. Sometimes I see laughing or texting. Not during the Lord's Supper. Nothing funny about that. There's nothing comical. There's nothing light about that. To be irreverent or indifferent. That's the biggest thing we struggle with. Just people are just indifferent. Some people are so distracted by their own stuff, their own problems, and we've all got them, that you just don't have anything left to even care. You're apathetic towards it. You're indifferent. Or to come with a bitter heart, or to have unresolved conflict with a brother, unresolved anger with a sister toward another person. Verses 28 and 31 basically say this. Let a man examine himself, or judge yourself so you don't have to be judged. I pray that a lot. Lord, help me to keep things straight so that you don't have to come down here and get me straight. I humble myself before you, Lord. I don't want to be humbled, and I certainly don't want to be humiliated. I would rather humble myself before the Lord. Let a man examine himself. The psalmist said, and you remember this, search me, O God. That should be our attitude, young and old. Rich and poor, Christian for just a few weeks, Christian for 50 years. Search me, O God, and know my heart. See if there's any wicked way in me. Lord, show me where I'm failing and forgive me. I will make the changes that you require. I love you more than I love my sin, and I'm willing to call it sin, and I'll turn my back on it right now. That's the sales pitch. Don't wait for tonight. Don't even wait for the invitation. Do it right now. Think about what's going on in your life. And deal with sin. Deal with issues. Take advantage of this opportunity to evaluate yourself spiritually and get things right with your Creator. He is your Creator, whether you acknowledge Him or not. He wants a relationship with you. If you do not yet have a relationship with Christ, Mr. Lighty just shared it so simply today. Invite Jesus Christ into your heart. Give Him your heart, your life. Ask Him to forgive you of your sins. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Take advantage of the opportunity to get things right with your Creator, your Lord, your Master, your Savior, your Redeemer. This passage closes by explaining to us how seriously God takes Lord's Supper. And we should take it seriously too. A Christian is never in danger of losing his salvation. But you can see in this passage that a backslidden believer who takes Lord's Supper irreverently is in danger of chastisement. He's in danger of God's hand of discipline, including sickness and even death in certain extreme examples. Folks, it's essential that we evaluate ourselves, making the necessary changes. God will make our church what He wants it to be. God will bring glory to Himself however He chooses to do it. We don't have to come up with a new marketing scheme. We don't have to come up with a new clever sales pitch. We need to get right with God as individuals, as pastoral staff, as deacons, as teachers, as workers, as just members, as every single one of us. He will do what only He can do when we do what he's told us to do, and that is to keep short accounts of sin, to be very serious about our personal walk with Christ. So the invitation this morning and our partaking of Lord's Supper is all wrapped up into one. Be born again and receive eternal life. That's the invitation. If you're not saved, be born again today and receive eternal life and be eligible to participate in Lord's Supper. That's the only requirement. Do you have a relationship with Christ? If you do, you're eligible to participate. If you don't, I would ask that you would come, shake my hand, and I will pray with you. And you can give your heart to Jesus right now. Ask Him to forgive you of your sins. Make Him your Lord and Savior. But for the rest of us, I would ask you again, be honest. Just be honest. Be honest with yourself and with God about your spiritual condition. Repent. That's what this is about. He said, do this as often. Remember that? Do this as often. It doesn't tell us how often to do it. Some churches do it every week. Some churches do it once a year. We do it once a month. But as often as you do it, take inventory of your life. Don't wait for another scintillating message or a scintillating video or a scintillating speaker. You don't need that. Everything you need is right here in your lap. Take inventory of yourselves. Judge yourself. Examine yourself. Do not take this irreverently. We'll have deacons located at the back and at the front of the worship center. They'll take the juice. They'll take the crackers. Go, take one of each, and go back to your seat and take all the time you need to meditate. Don't wait for me. Our pianist will play. You can take your elements. You can sit down. You can do business with God. Take them as you feel led. Remember, do this in remembrance of me. That's what Jesus said. Maybe by us doing this a little bit differently today, it'll make you remember a little bit better than just going through the motions. Do this in remembrance of me. If you need someone to pray with you, you're invited to come forward. I will pray with you. At this time, I'd like to ask our deacons to come forward, our pianists to come. Would you pray with me as the deacons come forward and take the elements? I'm going to ask our deacons to stand in the front at the three different aisles in the back. We need somebody in the balcony. God in heaven, I just ask that you would move mightily during our time of invitation. Lord, if there's someone who needs to be born again, Lord, I pray that they would stand and come and talk to me about it. Lord, there may be someone who's already been born again, but they've never come forward. They've never even requested baptism, but today they need to do that. There may be ones here that are tired of floating around, and they need to make this church their home, a church that preaches your word, a church that stands on your word, regardless of what culture does, regardless of what politicians do, regardless of the fads and the winds of pop culture. Lord, I pray that you'd help Kingsland to take that stand, to be that church that takes the stand, and that you would bring us men and women and boys and girls and teenagers who will join and take part of this family and fight the fight with us in this community. The good fight, using the weapons of love and faith and righteousness and truth and salvation. Lord God, I pray that you'd move during our time of invitation now. I pray that you'd help us just relax, to settle down, to not be in a hurry, to allow your Holy Spirit to move throughout this congregation. Lord, there are individuals here that need a fresh touch. Lord, I pray that this would be the fresh touch. Lord, there's individuals that need your guidance. Lord, I pray that you'd give them guidance. There's some that have decisions that need to be made that only you can give them that final go-ahead. Lord, I pray that you'd do that. Lord, we have folks that are sick, looking for work, having marital problems, problems with their kids. Lord, all of these things we just lay down at the altar and ask that you would help us. But the truth is, Lord, we have a lot of Christians who are very worldly, who are very much in love with the world and not very much in love with you. They're critical. They're waiting to be entertained, when really what we need to be is confronted. And today we've been confronted by your word and by your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray that the change would begin with me. I pray the change would begin with these men, these deacons, with our teachers, with our leaders, with our committee leaders and our committee members, those who are on the forefront of ministry in this church. Lord, I pray that you would burn a red-hot passion, a love for you, based on the fact that you died for us, you shed your blood, you gave your body for us. Lord, we want to give our bodies, our souls, our lives, everything we have to you for your service. So, Lord, I pray that you'd move now during this time of meditation and reflection. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, our deacons are going to go ahead and take the elements. They're going to find different parts of the worship center to go to. Go to them. Take the juice. Take the wafer. Take your time. Go back to your pew. We're not in a rush. We'll probably sing a little song or something at the end. Partake of the elements when you're ready. And let's do business with God. Will you do that? Will you do that? Let's stand together. If you have a burden on your heart and you need someone to pray with you, come forward. Want to join our church, or you need help with anything like that. If you need someone to lead you to Christ this morning, come forward and shake my hand. I'll do that.
Stand and sing that song as well.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now
my chains are gone.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns.
My chains are gone. One more time.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Amazing grace.
You know, without the piano, let's go ahead and sing that first verse one more time. Lord, we love you and we thank you so much for what you've done in our lives today. And Lord, we thank you for your amazing grace and your unending love.
Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was
I see. Was blind, but now I see. Was blind, but now I see. Amen.
You may be seated. I'm going to ask Chris Finns to dismiss our service in prayer in just a moment. And what a wonderful thing on a day when we're talking about community, communion, family, that the Pito family has come and requested membership in our church. They've given their hearts to Jesus. Bobby has been saved and baptized, and they've gone through our new members class. And Bernie has gone through the new members class, gave his heart to Jesus, but he has come and requested baptism today, which I think is something to just congratulate him for. For the courage to come up and ask for that. Growing up in a different tradition, different denomination and all that. And we know that believer's baptism is by immersion. And Jesus, when he died, they didn't sprinkle a little dirt on him. Put him in the ground. That's why we baptize. That's why we immerse. To walk in newness of life. And you may have questions about your relationship with God. You may have needs in your life that are profound. We will help you. We have good men. These men on this front pew are just a portion of a few of our deacons. I love deacons' meetings. Now, find many Baptist preachers that say that. You won't. I love our deacons' meetings. I look forward to our deacons' meetings. We pray. And I'm not talking about little you know, Fu Manchu prayers. I'm talking about these men pray for you. They pray for our widows. They take care of our guests. They take care of the needy. And you may have a need in your life. Let one of us pray for you. Let one of us help you. And I know it's intimidating to walk down the aisle during an invitation in a service. You may want to come and talk to us afterward. That's fine. Folks, I want you to make sure you shake Mr. and Mrs. Pito's hand on your way out today. They are a blessing. They've been a part of our church family for quite a while. They're right at home. And if you have questions about Kingsland, just come to the new members class. They'll answer them for you. They'll let you know exactly where we stand on things. And it's a process that all of our new members go through because we want people to know what they're getting into. Becoming a member and being a member at Kingsland means something. And it's involvement, it's participation, it's faithfulness. And not to get saved, but because you are saved, because you love Jesus. And I'm going to ask Chris to give us a little insight on our picnic, and then he's going to pray and we'll be dismissed, okay?
Well, this is the news you've been waiting for all during the service. Ladies and gentlemen, our picnic will take place today. We are going to do it at the Family Life Center, though. What I would like, we're going to start off right about 4 o'clock or so, and it's not going to be a typical sort of lunch that we normally have at the Family Life Center, where we eat on one side of the gym, and then the other side, there's running around and screaming and all the other stuff going on. We're going to mix this up considerably and have ourselves an indoor picnic, okay? I've been praying throughout the entire service as to what to do and just really not sure how to do this. And during the Lord's Supper, I truly got an idea, which I can't say was from my own. But we're going to create an indoor picnic. Let the gym be for activity time, and we're going to eat out in the foyer, as well as having some games out there. Bring your favorite board game. We'll see if we can get a TV going with some nice videos for some of the younger kids that just want to sit down and relax, or even some of the senior kids that want to sit down and relax as well. We'll move things around as needed, but we're going to have a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful indoor picnic at 4 o'clock this afternoon. We have a lot of hamburgers. I'm not going to tell you the amount because then we have to figure out what everybody else is going to eat. And we have a lot of hot dogs as well. And we have lots of onions and tomatoes and plenty of drink to go around. Folks, we have enough food and I cannot eat it all myself. I can try and I can get into it, but I would love to have some assistance out there as well. Please bring your favorite side or maybe the side that you're just trying to get out of your cupboard for someone else to eat. That will work too. And if you can't bring something, then don't worry about it. We'll have enough there for you. So we invite everyone, please come out to the Family Life Center at 4 o'clock today and celebrate with us our independence our independence in this country and also our independence and freedom from sin, folks. This is not just a July 4th Independence Day celebration. We are celebrating our risen Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to ask Pastor Derek to go ahead and take part of this service today. He thought he was getting off easy. I'm going to ask him to come on up and close us in a word of prayer.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank you so much for this opportunity that we've had to examine our own hearts and our own lives, Lord. And I pray that this examination would continue to take place throughout the day as we remember what you have done in the service today and how you've worked in our hearts. And as we think about the words that the Pastor Pat said, that they would be burned into our minds, and that we would meditate on your word all day, and that we would continue this examination process, Lord. I thank you so much for dying on the cross for us so that we can have freedom from our sins, Lord. I thank you so much for your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness, and just for who you are, Lord. And I pray that we would be forever changed by that. In your name I pray. Amen.
Hi, my name is Pat Fiordalise. I'm the pastor right here at Kingsland Baptist Church in Chesterfield County. I want to thank you for connecting with us tonight. And our television show is called Connecting at Kingsland. And the reason for that is based on our motto, and that is connecting people with Christ. That's why we exist. We want to help you get connected with your Creator. And tonight, maybe you were inspired or you were touched to do that, and you realize you need a relationship with Jesus Christ. I would encourage you to give your heart to Jesus. Get down on your knees right now and repent of your sins. Ask God to forgive you for your sins. And invite the Lord Jesus Christ to come into your heart and save you. He loves you. None of us can work our way to heaven. The Bible is very clear about that. Ephesians 2:8 says that you're saved by grace through faith. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man could boast. So salvation is a free gift that the Lord offers you for the taking. And He wants to connect with you. And so do we here at Kingsland. If you'd like more information about our church, just go to the web, kingslandbaptist.com. Or you can call us if you have questions about anything. If you need help, if you need someone to talk to, if you have a prayer request, 275-1285. Call us anytime and we'll help you as best we can. You're invited to come worship with us any Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. You would be our honored guest and we'd love to have you here. And once again, tune in with us next Friday night at 6 o'clock for Connecting at Kingsland right here on Comcast 17. God bless you.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will drawing near, when this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. no more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. If I hear the voice of many angels sing, worthy is the Lamb, and I hear the cry of every longing heart, worthy is the Lamb, and I hear the voice of many angels sing, worthy is the Lamb, and I hear the cry of every longing heart. You are worthy, you are worthy, worthy is the Lamb.
I will rise when he calls my name.